I'm Jan Goodman. We are being filmed, as you can see. This is really an all-star cast. I mean, people have come here from Arizona, the Bay Area, and because we have this incredible crew of people here. I want to introduce Harvey Wasserman. And thank him for coming and being the, he and Mimi were the major force in pulling this together. So thank you, Harvey.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jan.
Let's have a gigantic round for Jan and Jerry. It's fantastic to see you all here. Thank you so much for coming. I want to point out that we had this meeting on this topic in 2000 after they stole the 2000 election. Nobody would have come. It's taken 16 years to get this issue into the mainstream, but we're now going to change this goddamn system and get us a true democracy. And one of the reasons we're here, Bob and I, this is Bob Fitrakis here, my co-conspirator. This is Dev Harris. And this is Greg Palast. Greg is the only one here who wore a yarmulke. And Bob and I have just finished, this is our seventh or eighth book, I don't remember, on election theft. This is the strip and flip selection 2016. This is what we're going to talk about today. So being a college professor, I'm going to pass these out. We will sell these at the back there for $10 if you want. But I'd like to pass them out so everybody can see. They're just literally hot off the press, so don't burn your hands. I want to introduce Mimi. I can't even begin to describe how great Mimi is. She's one of our fantastic activists and just absolutely brilliant, of course, movie star and to boot. And if I start to go further, I'll cry. So let me give you Mimi Kennedy.
Thank you. I'm wearing the same dress that we just redid our wedding vows in, just to each other, with a liberation theology bishop who, retired, so he hangs around and he does stuff for people who are lapsed and don't go to church. But I wore it today because I feel like we're at a wedding, and we got all the guests who should be here. Okay, I wore it because what we're doing here is we're making legitimate what has been whispered about, as if we were living in sin since 2000 as a democracy. And we've been whispering, we know what's going on, this is going on, and now we're going to say it out loud. We are speaking of it, we're letting the whole community know, these are our vows, everybody's here, and we're going to change this damn system. I took my LA poll working class. This is my 2 minutes, and then I'm going to tell you what the rest of it's going to be. I took it on May 15th, and as a poll inspector, I get the election guide and checklist. And what I love about this is it gives me standing to enter into every controversy that involves LA. And the tricks and the confusion, and LA is not party to it, I would say statewide, the California Secretary of State's office, which our dear Deborah Bowen did a lot to improve, yet did not get all the improvements, and we have our paper ballot, but we have, especially in our primary elections, we've undone the bubble ballot problem, and now we have 10 possible ballots that you have to know which one you deserve to get your vote in for president on election day. And if you missed one postcard, if you're a vote by mail voter who is a nonpartisan NP, you have to know that designation, not independent, that'll get you into the American Independent Party, from which you can only vote for American Independent presidents. If you're an NP and you missed a postcard, you get a ballot in the mail with no presidential choices on it. And there are probably tens of thousands of especially new, inexperienced voters statewide holding this ballot. And I am trying to message what they can do is bring it in unvoted to the polling place they should be at, which they again must go to the California Secretary of State website to find out, another hurdle, and if they turn it in there unvoted at the correct website, they can vote a regular NP-Dem ballot for president. If they end up at their wrong polling place, they go to their friend's polling place and say, I can turn this in at the polling place. If it's not their polling place, provisional ballot.
Yeah.
If they forget the ballot, provisional ballot.
Oh, wow.
If they're by mistake American Independent and they want to vote Democrat, provisional ballot. And they won't be able to do it because they really will be in the wrong party. Those are the kind of tricks, but I want...
What's wrong with a provisional ballot?
Ah, gee, Greg, I don't know. Somebody I know named Greg Palast doesn't like. Anyway.
What's wrong with provisional ballot?
Oh, yeah, it's, well, they count them in L.A., maybe 46,000 or so are left over, but they start a week after the election.
Sure.
And then when they do have, I will read you here, there is a number you can call as a provisional voter in LA now to find out, was your ballot accepted, and if it was rejected, why? That's new. We fought for it, and it's in this big book. So I know it because I took training. How many provisional voters do you think are going to know it? And I want to reassure you, because of your activism, and I'm on that community voter outreach committee where I bring the things you're complaining and I'm complaining about to the registrar. We've got a pretty good system as you can manage these complications with, as good as it can be. There are still problems, and here's what we're gonna hear today. I just wanna tell you, we've got the all-star lineup. We've got Greg Palast, Harvey Wasserman, Ben Harris, Fitrakis, and from Arizona, John Brady. We each have about 6 minutes because it's so much, but I want Harvey to talk about the strip and flip election, and he's going to tell you the framing about the history of Jim Crow. Okay, then I just want to say, then we're going to go to Greg, whose specialty is the strip, what they're doing, the voter rolls. Then we're going to go to Bob Fitrakis, whose specialty is the flip, what they've done, what he's litigated in court, what those results have been. Then we're going to go to Bev. She's going to tell you how they're doing it, and this is big news. And then we're going to go John Brakey, because he's an example of somebody who's been dealing with the consequences of what Bev found even before Bev found it, and he'll then we'll have questions and answers. Okay. Thank you, and now to my great friend, Harvey Wasserman.
I can quickly mention Diablo Canyon. This reminds me of the anti-nuclear movement when we started in 1973. No one would pay attention to us. We came up with the slogan, no nukes, and now we have had thousands of people arrested at nuclear power plants. We've made a huge difference. We have shut 33 atomic reactors in this country. The two that hang above our heads are of course, the two at Diablo Canyon. I hope in August that we can do an event around Diablo Canyon. We were getting closer to shutting those two reactors, but it has all of LA in its death grip, and we really need to deal with that issue. And it's one of the reasons I'm encouraged by the turnout here, because we do have a democracy rising in this country. It has a lot to do with Bernie, but Bernie only arrived or came up because people are discontent. And we do have a grassroots upheaval in this country. And I want to say as we proceed, we get in these meetings at the negatives, we have a clear plan of what we want. Bob and I came up with what we call the Ohio plan. We want universal automatic voter registration. When you turn 18 years old, you are a registered voter. All you need to do is get a form at your high school, your college, the Bureau of Motor Vehicles, the Ralphs, wherever you are, get a voter registration card, sign it, send it in. That's it, and you are registered. No problems. We should also have, of course, same-day registration on election days. We want a four-day national holiday for voting. Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. No more of this having to take off of work. Saturday, the non-Jews vote. Sunday, the Jews vote. And everybody else on Monday and Tuesday. Okay? So, and we should have off. The polls should be worked by high school and college students and our elders at $15 an hour. Okay, and then, most important of all, universal hand-counted paper ballots. No more of this electronic machine bullshit, okay? Yeah, and then the ballots have to be kept for 2 years, and there are automatic recounts. And recounts should be automatic. The ballots stay exactly where they are. You know, we've had chain of control issues, but they don't move. It's ironic, in an era of electronic media, it'll be easier to monitor the hand count or vote count. They just sit there. In Ohio, in 2004, we had ballots going all over the state, you know. So there was a referendum in San Francisco, the ballots wound up in the Bay, of course. We just want them sitting there, and the kids and the elders will count the ballots, and that's it. They'll be on paper, recycled paper, or on hemp. We'll keep the hemp ones. After 2 years, the hemp ones will smoke. So we have a clearer plan than we want. Now, we understand Jim Crow is not with us today, but we have to understand that Jim Crow has been with us since the beginning of the Republic, and that's part of what this book is about. The Constitution was a fraud. It was written as a coup d'etat in a room with 55 white guys. No one was allowed in. They had an armed guard at the door. George Washington presided, said nothing for 4 months, but nonetheless, they came out, and the Republic was against the Constitution, by the way. And there were 13 state conventions, most of them rigged. We know, in fact, that the New York one had a majority of against the Constitution, and they took a vote, and three votes switched, and those guys wound up becoming very rich, and we wound up with a Constitution. Wow. Thankfully, though, because of meetings like this that rejected the Constitution, we wound up with a Bill of Rights. And that's the only reason we have a Bill of Rights. So in our history now, there have been five Jim Crows. Slavery, which of course made blacks non-human, really, subhuman, and there was a reason for that. There was the structure of American slavery was very political. It was designed to separate the races. It was not just a labor system. It was meant to make black people subhuman compared to white people so that whites and blacks would not get together and rebel, as they did in 1675 in Bacon's Rebellion. I won't take you further than that, but actually there was a political reason why slavery was so fierce in this country. After the Civil War, there was another Jim Crow of segregation, again, to keep blacks and whites from uniting. It was very political, very clearly about that, okay? And then we went into a period where we conquered other countries. We're still doing that. We're still in a perpetual war, very racist. We have overturned over 200 governments in our past 200 years, and we seem to have gotten it down pretty well, thanks to George H.W. Bush and the CIA and all that stuff. Now, what happened then is that all this bounced back. I'm going to give you a quick history. In 1988, the first use of electronic voting machines in New Hampshire. Guess who the beneficiary was? George H.W. Bush. He was running against Bob Dole. He was behind in the polls by 8 points on election day, and won the election by 9 points. It's a virtual statistical impossibility. This was the introduction of electronic voting machines into America. The next Jim Crow is the drug war. Now, I think many of you have understood, especially because of the brilliant book by Michelle Alexander, The New Jim Crow, that the drug war was very, very specifically about preventing black people and young people from voting, and about installing a police state. And John Ehrlichman, those of us who are old, none of you are old enough, but I remember Watergate, you remember John Ehrlichman, and he was quoted very recently specifically as saying that the drug war was engineered to punish and to oppose and to suppress the blacks and the hippies, because that's who Nixon hated. And we have had, Bob and I figured this out, 41 million arrests in the United States since 1971, wow, which is larger than the population of about 130 countries in the world. We have the largest prison population in the world, and in a so-called democracy, both by percentage and by number, and it's not an accident. It's predominantly black and Hispanic, as you know, and that is basically to disenfranchise those two communities. So the final Jim Crow now it's no longer enough, right? Because the demographic in this country has changed. Now we come to electronic voting. And thanks to Bev Harris's great work in 2000 and unraveling this onion ever since then, we know that electronic voting machine, what's the quote from Ronnie Duggar from the Texas Observer? I was talking to him in Ohio after the 2004 theft, and we were talking about electronic voting machines. He did one of the first articles about it for the New Yorker. And he said, and I quote, "Electronic voting machines are perfectly designed to steal elections. That's what they're about. As long as we have electronic voting machines, we are not going to have a democracy. It's as simple as that." Now, Bernie has advocated a hand count of paper ballots, universal. We need the full package. We need the automatic voter registration, the four-day holiday, the paper ballots, and then we can move to a real democracy and get rid of Jim Crow, finally. And that's what we're about. So, you know, we in the anti-nuclear movement, we're about converting to renewable energy. We know we can do it. This will be, LA will be the solartopia, actually, of solar energy. We can and will be continuing to shut these reactors. And in a parallel fashion, we're going to move to hand-counted paper ballots. We have to get there, or we're just not going to have social justice or even a planet to live on. So thank you very much. I'm honored by the presidents of these wonderful activists and all of you. Please give us your emails before you leave. Either give me a card, make sure you sign something with an email, because this is not just a meeting where we get together and we say we had a really interesting discussion. That's the thing about the Bernie campaign. I'll finish with this. All the Bernie supporters need to be converted to community organizers. If we have to understand that this four-year ritual we go through of yelling at each other about who we're going to vote for, and then it's over, and you know what we got. We need community organizers. We need the tens of millions of people who were energized by this 74-year-old Jewish guy to come out and become full-time activists. And I'll finish with this last quote. I once asked A.J. Musty, who was a famous, wonderful nonviolent organizer. I said, you know, he was old, I was young. What's it like to have devoted your whole life to being a social activist? And he said, well, the pay's no good, but the work is steady. So that's for all of us, except the pay is great because we get to have a planet to live on in a democracy. So thank you very much. And I'm honored to be here.
Greg Palast, many of you know, needs no introduction. He gave me this, which I really want to read because it was pretty great. Catherine Harris, no relation to that Harris.
And him, Deb Wasserman Schultz is no relation to me.
We're good, no Florida here. Catherine Harris calls Greg twisted and maniacal. Did you say takes one to know one? In Britain, he is, of course, considered the most important investigative reporter of our time. He's worked for BBC Television and The Guardian, such a great newspaper, wish we had one. He's now reporting for Rolling Stone magazine, completing a film about vote thieves and billionaires based on his New York Times bestsellers, two books, The Best Democracy Money Can Buy, and Billionaires and Ballot Bandits. And he's gonna cross-check what we just said. Hint, hint. All right, Greg Palast.
I'd like to give you good news, but instead I'm gonna report the news, okay? Which is something that doesn't often happen. And I gotta tell you, I'm not here because I'm for Bernie or Ernie or anyone. I am here. I am a reporter with Rolling Stone now, investigating what's going on with this election and your vote. And what really piqued my interest is something that a guy named Donald Trump, who's running for president, said in January. He said, there are people voting many, many times. Okay? Which people? Now, if you know a guy named Dick Morris, who used to be the senior counsel to Bill Clinton until he got caught with calling the White House while a hooker sucked on his toes. And he said that there are a million Democrats who voted twice in the last election for president. That's how Obama got elected. Now, that was worth to me investigating who's making these claims. And here's what's interesting, is that, okay, according to 29 state officials, they have developed a program called Interstate Cross-Check. So they know if someone's voting in two different states at the same time. Okay? And they have found these illegal voters. And you know how many they have found?
Zero.
7.2 million voters, according to the GOP voting officials, have voted twice.
John Smith. Yeah.
Now, they are carefully going through the program to eliminate. By November, we expect to see Well, let's see, Virginia's already removed 41,000 people, the swing state of Virginia, before the Democrats took over that office. Swing state of Virginia is 41,000, 12% of their list. Based on the Virginia numbers, at least 1 million people will have lost their right to vote by November. How do I know this? This is what I've been investigating for almost two decades. Okay. Now, are people voting twice? Well, let's see. You know, maybe Mr. Trump is not insane. Maybe he's uncovered something extraordinary. But somehow this smells a lot like Catherine Harris returns. See, back in 2000, I saw that black people were having trouble voting in Florida. And I thought, in my conspiracy nut head, I'm called a conspiracy nut by the conspirators, and my head that maybe there was a computer program erasing black names off the Florida voter roll. And then I found the computer program by Catherine Harris. And this is just a few names from it. I mean, you could go down the list. Like, this was what she found was that illegal, that there are felons, criminals, people with felony convictions not allowed to vote in Florida, that tens of thousands are on the voter rolls like this one. I just literally grabbed this a minute ago. Robert Moore was convicted of a crime in 1964. And because Robert Moore committed a crime, Bobby Moore lost his vote, or I should say her vote. It's Bobby Jean Moore. Because Robert Moore lost his vote, Bobby Jean Moore in Florida, committed a felony crime, Bobby Jean Moore lost her vote. Went through the list. There were 56,000. One thing I do know about this, right next to Bobby Jean Moore's name, it says BLA for black. And almost every name on that list had BLA. 56,000 people lost their vote, almost all of them BLA. And exactly this many, zero, not one, was an illegal voter. Not one. Joan Secker did a great film on this. Grab it. Now I smell this same thing, and sure enough, I was denied the list. They said it's confidential. 7.2 million people are committing a crime. Well, I can't get the list because it's a criminal investigation. I can't get the names of these 7.2 million suspects. But I'm an investigative reporter, so I got the list. Not all, but 2 million names. And so here's the people who are voting twice, okay? And this is literally, I'm just literally reading you random. I'm telling you it's random. Apparently the crime spree is headed by a guy named Michael Jackson. And so in Georgia, Michael Jerome Jackson voted, and then he voted again, Michael Jackson. In Virginia, Michael Wayne Jackson voted in Virginia, that's the same voter. Michael Leonard Jackson of Georgia was supposed to vote again as Michael Page Jackson. Now, you don't think possibly that it's just that there's a common name, Michael Jackson, no. So the middle names don't match in 2 million cases, 2 million. The junior, senior, father and son are locked in together, are tagged as the same person. And in fact, though, I did get one confessed guy, Willie Mae Nelson, who's it's actually not a woman. It turns out to be a singer named Willie Nelson, but he has pigtails, and he votes as, not only is Willie Mae Nelson, but Willie H. Nelson. I kid you not, he's on the list. But what's unusual about Willie Mae / Willie H. Nelson on the list is that he's not BLA. Now, they don't tell you the name. Since the end of the Voting Rights Act, we can't get the designation of the race. How convenient. But one nice thing is that the Census the Census Bureau gives us the racial breakdown of every last name in America. And this list, we put it, ran through the computer, and this is the sixth Jim Crow. We expect 1 million voters, almost all of them voters of color, to lose their vote in 29 Republican-controlled states before the November election. We're going to try to bust open this story. Please join me. Go give. If you have a way to help us get making a full-length film besides my writings, go to Chris Lee. Give him your name. If you want to help out, by the way, we've got a matching grant from the Park Foundation to help us match. And we are also putting out a podcast on the Pacifica Radio Network. You can go to my website, gregpalast.com. If you want more information on this, go to gregpalast.com. Sign up, obviously, for free for our weekly or so missives on the investigations as I'm covering them. The important thing is you're going to hear about how votes get flipped. Okay, Harvey and Bob have written an astonishing book, Strip and Flip. I'm talking about the strip, and what this means, there's an awful lot of African Americans, Hispanic Americans, and Asian Americans especially, who will not have their votes flipped because they will be stripped of their right to vote before they even get there. And that's one thing we must not forget. Jim Crow has returned. With the end of the Voting Rights Act, this is possible, this is happening, and this is the new Jim Crow.
And of course, the kind of cross-check is made possible by digitized voter rolls. At least, supposedly, we can check to see if our registration is stripped, because presumably our names on the registration lists we can see and check. Remember, in all that you are to hear, they are baldly doing that anyway. Now, when it comes to voting, we can never account for our votes, because our votes and ballots cannot account back to us. We have a secret ballot in the United States, and we have it for a reason. I did have a French guy call me up who was trying to ideate about the LA voting system. He said, they said I should speak to you about how important you think it is to have an anonymous vote still in the United States. Is it so important still if people know how you vote? I went, yeah. Because they repress, they suppress, they restrict, they contain, and they punish. Who is the they? The they is the opponent who has some power and does not have your best interest nor any moral interest at heart. And if we haven't seen enough of that exercising power, then we've been deaf, dumb, and blind. So I'll just say that. Now I'm going to turn to a great hero from Ohio, and he has been a Confederate with Harvey, a colleague of Harvey's. I'm not going to use the Confederate. He's been a conspirator, but it's not a conspiracy. Yeah, that he has written and litigated with Harvey Wasserman, and they started in 2004 because they didn't let it go by the way 2000 went by, except for Greg Palast and all of us. But and Joan Seckler, whose 2000 unprecedented film about that 2000 election is a great film. I just want to present him. He's, well, he'll tell you about himself, but Harvey, Bob, I know you, I'm 1 a.m. coming up from the East Coast, but Bob, I know you best as a lawyer as well as an editor and a journalist, but the judge you went before in 2000, and I believe it was 8 or 12?
8.
Knew you.
Oh, 12 too.
I know about the one in
2012.
2012 knew you too. At last you got into a courtroom with a judge who said the right thing, because he said, Mr. Fitrakis, I know your work. I'm glad to see you in my courtroom.
All right, glad to be here. And again, Cindy Asner's here, and she provided great help for us in 04 from this area. Again, I just recently testified before the Congressional Black Caucus, and the only person who's really got it there over the years was John Conyers, who helped us tremendously. But my opening remarks were simple. If you allow private, partisan, for-profit companies to secretly count your vote with proprietary software, you must want it hacked. What we have created, and I say this, right, it's a faith-based system. It is push and pray. There is no way to verify it. And when some, you know, like I have a PhD in political science as well. That's how I make my money. So when I state the obvious, we have a non-transparent system. Why does that make me a conspiracy theorist as opposed to a realist? Right? I'm an international election observer. I went down to El Salvador after the revolution. I went down there and I went to the conflictive zone where the Mano Blanco was, where the guerrillas were, and we negotiated an agreement. They could agree on one thing. We want a see-through box. We want to see everyone put the ballot in. And with that, we want a see-through box. We want the ballots in. We want them open before the world, before the UN observers, before the international election observers, before the media, because we don't trust each other. Had I been there, and Urena said, it's not a problem, we've hired some right-wing desk squad. They're now in IT. They'll be secretly counting the vote with proprietary software. Software would save time. I would have said presumption of fraud.
Yes.
That is the basis of our system today.
Yes.
Is that, and who are these companies? It's like, well, Seidel, that's from Barcelona, Spain. It's counting our vote. What else does it do? Well, its CEO helps negotiate deals between Titan and buying up L7. You remember Titan? They were in Abu Ghraib with khaki torturing people, their employees raping youth, underage youth, and getting away with it.
Wow.
That, you know, Boulderton Capital, Vulcan Capital. Boulderton is tied to British intelligence. What do they own? When I look at this company, Seidel, they own Carrier IQ. That's the third-party app on your phone that spies on you. That turns your video camera on and turns your recorder on. And what do they want mobile applications. Shouldn't we be voting on the phone? We've got an app to make it safe. But we also own Carrier IQ, which spies on everything.
Yeah,
so on a basic level, I'm stunned that at this point in history that they can get away with this. Here's my theory, right? If you trace it back, that which they used to do covertly in the Third World, which is one of our Jim Crows, the secret stealing of elections, they overtly have brought to the United States. And you're seeing it in this election more than any time in history, right? Those of you who follow that. 24 of the first 26 primaries have a shift to Hillary Clinton. But in 11 of them, the shift is so fundamentally large, if we look at the unadjusted exit polls, that they're statistically impossible. You're talking about the one in a billion, right? Our State Department has manuals, and through the AID, the Agency on International Development, if Hillary Clinton had those victories outside US territory, we would say they're under investigation for fraud by AID standards. The same way we challenged Putin's election and the Ukraine election, is that 11 of these are so statistically far out of line, they would not be accepted for our government anywhere in the world. We can't let this stand. We've got to demand full transparency. What does Jimmy Carter say about this? He's been asked, why don't you observe American elections? They're non-transparent. What did he tell Der Spiegel? He said, America does not have a functioning democracy. Harvard and the University of Australia at Sydney rated us 47th out of 47th. I know there's certain Republicans that raise the slogan, why not the worst? But I think in our assumption, we can demand full transparency in elections. And we can bring these issues forward. We got words, right? One of my favorite words is recalibration. What the hell does that mean? Well, the computer was recording wrong, right? Yeah. Or it was flipping votes. So we use these nice terms. Well, we recalibrated it. Oh, well, that's nice. At least it wasn't flipping votes. Yes, it was. That's what recalibration means, you know? And you've seen this over and over again. Look at a company like Seidel, which bought up SOE, right? In 2012, it was able to directly input into the central tabulators in 36 states. It was an honor system. They promised not to mess around. And no matter how close they are in interactions with Booz Allen Hamilton or investment from the Carlyle Group, it's a trust system, and they wouldn't do anything to interfere with our elections. So on the one hand, we have this tremendous amount of statistics, and I'm a social scientist here, indicating someone's tampering with our election. On the other hand, when people raise the issue, they call us the C word. It's like, again, does it make sense that Hillary Clinton keeps winning the Super Lotto, the Classic Lotto, the Powerball, the Pick 5, the Pick 4, and the Pick 3 11 times in one election cycle?
Absolutely.
I think it needs to be investigated, and that's what we should be doing.
I met her back in Sacramento when a lot of us, Robin Gibson, many people here, and some were not here, Judy Alter, I wish you were here, went to protest Diebold, perhaps getting recertified after Kevin Shelley, the Secretary of State, had thrown it out of our state for using uncertified patches and software in our elections. Yeah. They hounded by the Republicans and his staff that had been left over from Pete Wilson, a Republican governor, out of office.
And the Democrats.
And they replaced him once Arnold Schwarzenegger had won that recall election, which Judy Alter will tell you, most of the votes for Arnold Schwarzenegger came from the places that already had all electronic, paperless voting. Lo and behold, oh, that was so popular, but many votes for Arnold Schwarzenegger. So anyway, he installed a Republican Secretary of State, Bruce McPherson, and there were some hearings about letting Diebold back in. And we went there. I met Bev Harris there, and thus began an amazing, we would have called it correspondence in the 19th century. It was occasional phone calls and emails. And she, by doing the quiet work of data, I guess what, data research. She knows spreadsheets and Excel and all kinds of things that I don't understand, has uncovered amazing stuff. She works with others. She knows digital and source code better than anybody. And she called me about 3 months ago saying, what I found, I almost can't believe. And I felt sick to my stomach. She confessed the same thing. We both wanted chocolate chip cookies. We're on the phone. Oh. And what it is, in a nutshell, is that none of us are one person, one vote. We are all one person, 100/100ths of a vote. We are fractioned in the software that she found from 2001. We're not sure how far back it goes, but since 2001 and Diebold. Diebold and the SNS have been owned together. They were started by brothers. Sequoia has been owned by Diebold, Premier, now Dominion. So I call what you're about to hear an STD. They've all kissed, and it's a software transmitted disease. So now you're going to hear how deep it goes. There are 7,000 small voting jurisdictions all over America. State law controls elections. 7,000 jurisdictions within and among those states can have some say in process, procedure, private contractor to come and service your software, service your hardware. You kind of have to hire an IT guy who's a county employee, but they might not be the brightest bulb on the block. So you have to rely on these private contractors who
know, you know, like the Mercedes-Benz dealership that, you know, we know Mercedes-Benz, you know, we know Diebold, we know ES&S, we license for them. And they're, now you're gonna hear from Bev Harris, and you know, it's who, what, when, how, and why, and we're gonna hear how. Bev Harris!
Yeah. You know, it's hard to shock me anymore, especially since I, over the past 10 years after I found the Diebold files, have gone around the country and done field work, and I've chosen some of the most knowingly corrupt local locations because it was my idea that it would be a little easier to peel apart the onion if I could get into something that wasn't so high powered as a presidential election, and I could see how they're doing this. And that has borne quite a bit of fruit. And by the way, electronic voting and the whole thing, as Bob mentioned, all this was way back in the 80s, maybe even the 60s that it started. But let's look at 2000 from there. In 2003, I stumbled upon the Diebold files. They were on a fairly obscure FTP server, downloaded 7 CDs worth of files, didn't know what that meant, why I was finding them. So I called, I don't know, Greg Palast, and I said, well, I don't know if it's legal if I download these, and I don't know what's in them. And I'll never forget what he said. He said, well, you know, if what's in them is pretty bad, they're gonna throw the book at you.
Yeah.
But if what's in them is really bad, probably not too much will happen. Well, what was in them was really bad. But I didn't know how bad. And you know, the thing is, when you get large dumps of information, like you see with WikiLeaks and all that, a lot of it has, it evolves over time as more information comes through. In 2010, I did one of my local deals, and I went to Memphis, Tennessee, because they had an odd election whereby really very primarily densely African-American Memphis had and Democratic had decided to vote in a complete slate of white Republicans. And there were 10 black Democratic candidates that sued, and because of that we were able to get discovery. And during the course of getting to the discovery, we ended up with something we never expected to get. Now they obstructed every single thing they could obstruct. I was so frustrated that finally, I went there with Susan Pinchon. For any of you who saw Hacking Democracy, she's the wonderful woman who cried at the end. She's also a marvelous investigator and activist. Well, we went there and I said, you know, they're not giving us anything. Let's just ask them for a list of the file names on their own computers. I mean, I don't even know what that would do, you know. So we said, okay, we went, you, tell us the list of names of files on your computer. We come in and they are loading their computers onto carts that have wheels on them, running out the door with them, stuffing in cars and driving away. And so, happened to have a good judge at the time. He came down to the facility. He said, there was only one that hadn't driven away by that time. He said, bring that thing in here, let's open it up. They had erased it at 5:15 in the morning. We're like, well, it must be good, whatever is on them. So, the judge said, you know, I bet you guys have backup drives. Why don't you give those to me and we'll put them in the bosom of the court until the trial. Well, they did. They're on these old-fashioned mag tapes, and there was 5 of them. And we got them a day before the file, lots of time to prepare, and they were encrypted. So there was nothing we could do. They then switched out the judge, got a white Republican judge in there, and he said, oh, this is not interesting, and he dismissed the case. Well, one of my favorite quotes, Richard Hayes Phillips, when he went to look at the Ohio ballots, he said, and they would say, well, the election's over, get over it. And he said, you know, I'm a historian. I have all the time in the world. So the court date was over. Encrypted files. I took them into a local place to see if they said, we can't even get at it. I made contact with someone in Europe, you know with which kind of organization, Anonymous. And they de-encrypted the files. when you've seen some things where they know how to do an SQL and tamper the voter database, they do know because they have copies of the voter registration database, same thing I have. They have the same thing I found. Now, it's still kind of sat there. I mean, God, now I'm going through five hard drives full of information. I get all the voter registration lists going back to 10 years. I can see that they've taken 13,000 black voters and made them white. That's part of the deal. I can see that they've taken 11,000 voters, all black, and said they no longer voted, even though they did, because there it is. And so they can be purged. Lots of games like that. I can see that they took the electronic poll books and they changed the stuff that was in the electronic poll book so that people who had asked for a Democratic ballot were said to have asked for a Republican ballot and voted Republican. So there was this massive messing around with this stuff. Guess who I was up against? I was up against a guy who is now, he's a brilliant lawyer. He is now the chief counsel for the Republican National Committee, and they say they're going to tap him to become the chair. Now, in Shelby County, it's a microcosm of what's happening in the United States.
Make sure you say it's not the Shelby of Holder v.
Shelby County, Tennessee. Two Shelbys, both have racial problems.
Yeah.
But Shelby County, Tennessee has a problem. If you're white and Republican, you don't have enough of you to win. And you have to make yourself get power. They have taken total control of that county for 10 years now, and it's a mystery to everyone. So we move forward to 2014. They have an election. It's a very odd election. Judge Joe Brown from TV is running. He's decided he's going to run for local prosecutor. Now, if you want to believe this, Memphis, which is mostly black and Democrat, decided they would like to be prosecuted by the white Republican. But in comes a guy who has a little bit of political acumen, Benny Smith, his name is. And Benny Smith has three areas of expertise that we needed for this, to crack this case. He has political acumen, so he knows how you would rig an election. He has database development acumen, so he knows how databases are constructed. And he has accounting acumen. He moves around billions of dollars with lots of decimal places every day in his real world job. He said, you know, I don't think that it could be tampered, but there's an anomaly in Judge Joe Brown's race. It's one off. It's as if 2 + 2 = 5. Bigger numbers, one off. How does that happen? If you add up 10 votes, but those votes are 2.5 votes and 7.5 votes, the 2 rounds up to 3, 7 rounds up to 8, 3 + 8 = 11, you get one off. He sees this stuff every day in working with money. It's a problem when you start decimalizing things because you get these little fractions and they sometimes combine and make it one off. He found 22 rounding errors, all in the criminal justice system elections. So he said, you know, I want to look at those files you got back from Europe. And I'm going to look for one thing, and I don't think I'm going to find it, because how could I possibly find it? But I'm going to see if it decimalizes the counting of the vote. And because he knows how to do databases, he knew what computer instructions to look for exactly and where to look for them. To his amazement, the first thing he saw was to treat and count every vote as a fraction of a vote. Now, what that means is, instead of one person, one vote, you can be a half a vote, you can be 2.5 votes, you can be a 50th of a vote. So he thought, well, let me see if I can take this actual vote database, because we've got tons of those on those files, these actual votes, and let me see if I can just tell it, okay, give this guy 70% and give this guy 24.6% and see if it reallocates all their votes. It did. It took 4 seconds. So then he contacted me and he said, I think we have a problem here. I said, do you think just in Memphis, is that just where it is? He goes, no, I think this is in every single system in America. So I said, well, I got at least 40 databases from real elections. Let me look. It was in every database, in every race, in every single state where they were running this system. Gave me the script, I showed Mimi, it's just the awfulest feeling, because you can go so precisely. What you can do is say, in this precinct, for the voters that are black only, I would like in this race for them to get be counted as 3/5 of a vote, and in this race, wow, that's a tough race, we better only count them as like a fifth of a vote. It is that precise. So I said, well, Benny, we know it was in there. Could it be a glitch? No, they had to put it in there. So I said, well, if it's in there, if it's counting votes as fractions, this has to be somewhere documented, because they have to be certified, so they had to at least lie or do something sort of so that if anyone asked them, there'd have to be some kind of a reference. 2001, June 27th, 2001, one-liner. We made a change so that we could do weighted races. Weight. W-E-I-G-H-T. So we began to peel that back, and this is really still really unfolding. So here is what happened. In the 1980s, as well as all the other stuff with the Eurosovitz brothers and all that, there was a law firm. One of its senior partners is a guy named Eigel Crow, Bud Crow, was the head of the Watergate Plumbers Unit. One, their programmer and their accountant was a guy named Jeffrey Dean. Jeffrey Dean got in trouble because some of the firm, the law firm's partners got upset because they said, you're writing checks to yourself. And he claimed in his testimony, well, I was paying, he's a liar, so you don't know. He said, I was paying myself because me and some of the law firm partners had a project going we didn't tell the other law firm partners about. This is in his sworn testimony. Well, his, the project they weren't telling other people about, I don't know, but I can tell you who the clients of this law firm were. King County, which is the largest county in Washington State, the Washington State Democratic Party. Okay? Jeffrey Dean takes the fall. He's very pissed off later on when they ask him about why did you plead guilty? He says, I did not plead guilty. It was an Alford plea. I did not steal that money. It was compensation for something we were doing. I'm not Lily White. But, well, he is Lily White. He lives in Idaho now, in Riggins, Idaho. But at any rate, he goes to jail. He takes the fall. 1992. He comes out in 1996. Don't you think it's odd in 1992 when he goes to jail that King County Elections hires his brother and his wife to do their absentee program? That's just odd. He gets out in 1996 with $67 in his pocket, and somehow he flies off to Belgium and buys two printers that are super high end and they're worth $1 million each. He pays $2 million. Somebody made sure he had this money. And in 1996, before he's even out of prison, he's on work release, he is hired to help work with the absentee program in King County. In 1996 also, he then starts a ballot printing plant, immediately gets the contract to print the ballots for King County. And in 2000, he purchases, or he sells his ballot company to Global Election Systems, but it doesn't actually work like that. They actually, I don't know, there must be some name lawyers know, but essentially he got most of the stock. So he got a pile of money, and then he became the main stockholder for Global Elections. But sadly for him, because his wife now owned, she owed $2 million for these printers, and he owed $385,000 in restitution and was gonna go to jail if he didn't come up with this. Global Elections was insolvent and didn't have any of the cash to pay. So he's sitting on a pile of stock that is worthless, and along comes 2001, March. California allocates $300 million to buy new voting systems. And in June, just coincidentally, all of the programmers and the salespeople, there's only five or something, are suddenly waylaid. They say, stop whatever you're doing. We have a deadline. We have to get something completely rewritten in the program. They deliver it with 2 hours to spare. What did they deliver? Weighted races. 2 days later, they received a check for $5 million, took care of his problems. Check came from Diebold Inc.
Wow.
Now I wonder who had the design specs. Who said you have to do this? This stuff isn't something that I made up. In fact, let me read you the design specs. It's worse than even we thought. We're holding a vote by mail election. The hitch is each voter is apportioned a value or weight for their vote. To make things even more interesting, the rules for the weights vary by race. So voter X might be given weight 5 for race A and weight 12 for race B. It then goes through these specifications of all the different ways they want to do this. And then it says the solution, this is worse than we thought, is to print a barcode on each ballot to identify each voter. The high-speed central count absentee scanner scans the barcode, looks up the weight for the voter for each race on the ballot, and passes that information to the counter in the central tabulator gems. And then they go on to say it's going to add up pretty quick, a lot of significant digits, potentially millions of dollars for us.
Bev, what are you reading from?
This is an email between one of the owners of Global Election Systems and their programming staff. Okay, so that's basically where we're at, and I think we can guess what was going on here. They were having to create a system that, as they say in the Shark Tank, is scalable. Something where everybody could do the alteration of the races very quickly and easily and precisely.
Thank you. Beth Harris, ladies and gentlemen. Great, smart, and she's here to tell us. We look forward to telling everyone we know, and we look forward to reading more about it and seeing it on film. And we'll get rid of it, and we'll be counting ballots on paper. John Brakey is here, and he has worked so hard with Audit Arizona because he has seen local corruption in elections. He has understood something was going on. He has demanded evidence. He and the lawyer Bill Reisner, is Bill here?
No.
Okay. That have really had a lot of success in publicizing the hindrances to finding out what Bev got in a data dump. But I'll let you tell the rest of the story, John, and thank you for waiting.
Thank you very much. And, cause, you know, I'd say this, I'm honored to be up front here with these people because they're my mentors, okay? If it wasn't for the work that they've done, that I've built on, okay, and I know that at times I've called and been very pesky and asked a lot of dumb questions when people are really busy. And by the way, I love you, Bev, for putting up with me. And because we've uncovered huge things in Arizona, really big problems. I'm just going to go ahead and maybe quickly talk about just this last election. And because it was a strip, it was a flip, okay, as in their book. Okay?
So you're talking about the primary election in Arizona?
Yes, I certainly am. The primary election that happened, and the voter suppression that happened. We had 150,000 people in Maricopa County that were suppressed from voting, okay? Or at least we think that they were suppressed at the precincts, but we think there's a good possibility that their ballots were somehow destroyed or gotten rid of, because we're right now in Arizona 85% in a very dangerous thing called vote by mail.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Hideous. The games that can be played. You know, I kept wondering, you know, it was easy to prove 150,000 people were blocked just in one county, Maricopa, because all the other counties were up 8, 9, 16%. Maricopa's percentage was down 4%, okay? And so, you know, you don't have to be a mathematician to go ahead and figure out what was going on. When it came to numerous people, just like in your book, went to vote and they found out that they couldn't vote, and they were forced to vote in a provisional. And somehow they went into a motor vehicle or called, and the next thing you know, they supposedly a glitch. You know, it's that word that they use all the time when they steal. Oh, that's just a little glitch, you know, but there's not enough to steal an election. When the reality is that these people, distinguished people in this panel, have taught me that they just don't steal one way.
Right.
Okay, it's a little here, it's a little there, and if you're not careful, you're not going to find it. It is done, and it's tailored state by state. Now, I know my state of Arizona, and I know that ballots are not a public record, okay, and they can get away with it. I want you to know that I was in one case with my attorney for 9 years, and we never got to the ballots, and for 5 years, we paid storage for those ballots, okay? We went through the appellate process into the Arizona Supreme Court twice. First time, we won, sent back to the courts. The system was set up. They listened to us for 8 months and then threw the case out on the same reasoning. This is happening all over. But you know, I don't want to be just stand up here and tell you negative stories. I want to talk about hope and the change, because I recognize that maybe we've crossed the Rubicon, okay? Because people are calling it by the right name.
Yes.
They used to call this thing voter fraud.
Right.
You people,
right.
Voter fraud.
Right.
Yeah.
We know it's election fraud, okay?
Yep.
And election fraud is not gonna be a lot of people. My God, this system was designed to cheat. That is what she has proven. That's what they have proven in Ohio. And that's what we're proving in Arizona and other states. And you know, and that's why I'm a very big supporter of these people up here and what they've done and what they have all taught me. Thank you all. I mean, hey, she gave me Jim March.
Yes.
Oh my God, Jim March. It takes a geek to understand the geek freak language of elections.
Yes.
Okay, that's what I learned. And then what I'm seeing, because of the change that's happening, because we are beyond the Rubicon, we are in a situation because of the work that these people in Ohio did, the work, Great Palace, I love you. Thank you, okay? And thank you for putting up all the years with me calling or working with your staff or whatever. It's giving us the knowledge to be able to deal with this and say, I am a conspiracy factualist. I deal in facts. The system was built to cheat.